Hi, it's Bumble. Welcome back to my channel. Today I'm continuing with my review of the movie Raggedy Ann and Andy, A Musical Adventure. Last time we left off, because I've sort of been explaining the plot just a little bit as I've been, like, reading through my notes, there's this French porcelain doll who gets kidnapped by this kind of horny pirate toy, and Raggedy Ann and Andy are gonna go rescue her. So they jump out the window, and there's, like, this whole scene where they're, like, kind of flopped over and stuff, and they're talking, and then they go into the woods, and they're, like, really scared. It's, like, a whole little thing. I wrote, like, a bunch of stuff for that, actually, because it's just, it's so cute. Like, Andy only really goes, like, Anne's full-on ready to go rescue Babette or whatever, and then Andy mentioned something about wanting to go just so that he could protect Anne, because he's like, oh, yeah, I'm going, someone's got to protect you, Andy, and that's always so sweet. And it's like this, it's this kind of moment, like, before the first song in the section where it's like, you get to see what their relationship is like with each other, and I think that's pretty neat, because I feel like they both sort of try to be more like a certain kind of personality when they're with the other toys. Like, Anne is, like, very friendly and tries to be brave and sort of look after everyone, and Andy tries to be, like, very macho and tough and whatever. But then it's shown, like, when they're, like, with each other and they're in this spooky forest or whatever, it's like they're both actually scared and don't really know what they're doing. So I thought that was neat to kind of just show that, like, they both just let their guard down and they're scared. I mean, like, yeah, they're in the forest at night, but I mean, they're also, like, these tiny rag dolls, and, you know, something could easily get them or whatever, so makes sense they're scared. Anyway, I wrote how there's this noise Anne makes, like, when they jump out the window. She's the first one to jump out the window. It's not, like, a super high fall, but I mean, for them, it's a high fall. So she lands on the ground and makes this noise. It's probably her just saying, like, ow or something. But with the way it sounds exactly like the Roblox oof noise. You know, the one that's like, oof. It sounds exactly like that. Like, I keep noticing all these little things in the movie, like the Raggedy Ann thing I mentioned, where it's like, you know, those memes and all that stuff didn't obviously exist back then. So then, to have that, like, just genuinely there and having that, like, hindsight is just really funny to me, where I keep noticing all this stuff that was, like, you know, probably just, like, normal, whatever, and made sense with the movie, but then, like, seeing them with the meme perspective just changes things and makes things funnier. But yeah, I like how, like, they both jump out the window, and then they're, like, flopped over and their limbs are all over the place, and they're, like, from that point on, like, in the forest and stuff and everything, they talk, like, really whispery and soft and stuff, and I really like that. Almost like ASMR for me. But, yeah, like, they're all scared, and they both ask each other, like, oh, if they're okay, because they tumbled down, and they're fine, and then they're in the woods, and they're, like, basically clinging on to each other because they're both really scared. And then Andy does this thing where, and he asks Anne if she's scared, and she's like, yeah, and he's like, oh, well, I'm not. And then he gives this little speech where he pulls out this paper daisy that was in his pants, and it's this whole thing of, like, at some point pre-movie, he got put in with, like, the washing machine stuff with starch and accident, and he's scared, but then he stops being scared because he has this paper daisy that Raggedy Ann made for him. I refer to it just in my notes as the paper daisy speech. But one of the things he says during that, like, he pulls out the daisy and he says, I wasn't scared, and here I'm reading from quotes, when someone really cares for you and they give you something really special, it makes you feel good all the time. And that's, like, one of my favorite parts of the whole movie, just that quote. And I honestly think about that a lot. Like, I watched the movie originally by myself, and then I watched it with my friend, because at that point, this was one of my, like, obsessions, basically. And I was like, yeah, you gotta watch this cute movie with me about the dolls or whatever. And we got to that part, and I don't remember what I said to him exactly, but I said something like, yeah, you the stuff you do makes me feel like that, and he's really happy about that. And it was sweet. So it's like I have that little moment I think about with that line, but I think about the actual line. It's a really cute line, honestly. Anyway, then him and Anne are talking about that incident of him in the washing machine or whatever, and Anne is kind of giggly, and she says something like, oh yeah, you can move for weeks or something, and she's like waddling around, and then she just flops over, I think because she laughs too hard, like she does this little like giggle and then just flops over. And it's just, like, the cutest thing in this movie, man. She's so wholesome. And, like, that giggle just sounded so innocent in the way, because, you know, I mentioned the dolls are kind of floppy. They're rag dolls, the way she just kind of flops and falls over from being too excited and giggly. This movie's so wholesome. That's the thing. The movie's, like, the whole movie, from the characters to the stuff that happens, is pretty freaking weird. And I'd say the designs for some of the characters they meet, like, if a child was watching this, would probably find it kind of scary. But there's also so many wholesome moments in this, too. Even just, like, little things like what I've mentioned, especially with the two main characters. Because, I mean, everything else is creepy and weird, but they're not. They're just these little dollies and... Yeah, there's a reason this movie's one of my comfort movies that I'd put on like, a rainy day or something. But yeah, then they sing this song when they're in the... That just takes place with them going through the forest, and when the song ends, they get out of the forest, and it continues from there. But it's this song that's called Candy Hearts and Paper Flowers. I'm pretty sure it's called that because, you know, Andy has the paper flower, and... It's revealed later that Raggedy Ann literally has a candy heart. But yeah, the paper flower, like, the melody for it, and literally the flower that Andy has, pops up every once in a while. Like, they'll be, like, singing, and he'll, like, pull out the flower or something, and a little tune will play. And I really like that. But anyway, that song, out of everything in this movie, is my favorite. It's so wholesome. And it's really well sung, actually. It's great. Like, that show set... wait, no, I'm getting ahead of myself, I'm sorry. I honestly wanted to paint some of the shots that I saw, because it's the characters, because it takes place at night, so everything's really dark. But it's like the characters are walking around holding hands, and Andy's... The one that's mainly singing in the song... It's like him singing to Anne, and he's holding her hand and kind of moving her along through the forest. And then they have these really pretty, like, watercolor night backgrounds, and they're just so nice and having the characters there. I'd pull up a picture, but I don't know if that would get rid of the recording I have right now. Hold on, let me actually get a visual on this myself so I can talk about it. Because I took a screenshot while I was watching. I took a few screenshots of things I liked. Okay, yeah, I'm looking at one of the shots, and it's like they're holding hands, and Andy's got the flower, and I really like the opening with the song, because you see the moon, and it's kind of like, it has that same effect as the sun from earlier, where it's just like a giant white ball, and it basically looks like an area that they didn't paint, basically. But I like how, even though everything's dark, it's not like pitch black, everything's actually just brown, basically, like they're working on trees and stuff, and that's brown. And there's plants, but they're like a very, very dark green. And then the background I could tell is watercolor, and I really like, because even though it's night, you'd think like, okay, it's going to be the moon and then a black sky with stars or something. But no, it's just like this really, really light shade of brown for the background. It kind of almost reminds me of like when people would paint with coffee, but like a lighter color. And I think that looks really cool. I think that was a great choice. Especially because next to the moon, you can actually see that the sky is a little black. And if you look close, you can sort of see stuff that looks like stars. So it's kind of like the browns more of, like, funny colored clouds that are going by. And there's a part in the song where they're, like, hiding because they're scared. And they're seeing, like, shadows on the ground. And then it shows the moon and it's revealed, like, okay, it's just a cloud and stuff. Like, they never actually run into any danger in the forest. Like, they're never attacked by anything or whatever. Until, like, a later part of the movie. But, like, they're both really scared and wandering through. And you still get that feeling of danger a little bit, though, because they're in these dark brown places and whatever. The version I'm watching, by the way, is the 35mm transfer. That's the specific one that I was watching. So, like, the shot I'm looking at is at the timestamp 2840, for example. Anyway, back to my notes. Like, the whole segment and everything between the song and them jumping out the window, like I said earlier, shows how even though Andy tries to be tough, he's actually just as scared as Raggedy Ann is. Actually, he seems more scared because she's scared, but she's, like, willing to do whatever she needs to do to rescue Babette, and then meanwhile Andy's, like, kind of a little more spooked. So I find that kind of funny. The only weird thing with the song is how the lyrics, if you listen to them, are basically a love song, except it's because they're siblings. He's like her younger brother or something, canonically. So it's sung from a sibling to another sibling with like lyrics of a love song, and it's like kind of weird. Because the thing is, if you didn't know, like it was from Raggedy Ann and Andy, like if you had the same voices or anything, whatever, and you just like heard the song like on a radio or something, or like a different movie, you'd think like, okay, yeah, that's like a romantic song. Like even at the end of this song, they both sing one of the lines together, they harmonize, and their faces get really close to each other, and you think they're gonna like kiss or something. It's weird. It's kind of the same vibes of okay, actually when I'm posting this, like I've been recording like a bunch of Portal 2 stuff, and then I recorded this video, but I'm realizing, so you're not gonna get the reference, but like when I'm posting this, this is gonna be in like late October. I'm recording this like literally October 1st though. And then the Portal 2 stuff that I'm gonna refer to is posted in like late November. So if you come back to watch this, then you'll get this. But this song and the vibes kind of reminds me of one of the songs in the Portal 2 musical, where it's the same sort of thing where they're like two characters that aren't actually lovers. In the Portal 2 case, it's just that they're friends and they sing this duet together that feels very much like one of those, like, kind of like this, where it feels like it's supposed to be a romantic duet, and they even do the thing where they, like, harmonize at the end and get very close to each other, but in either case, like, they don't kiss or anything. Actually, wait, no, in the Portal one, they do kiss, but not, like, on the lips or anything. One character just kisses another one, and then that character, like, faints or something. Busts the fuse or whatever. I find that interesting because I recorded that video yesterday, so I still kind of have that on my mind. And I don't know, I'm so used to movies having, like, you know, you got the two romantic leads. They're always going to sing a romantic duet, and then it's the kiss or whatever. That seeing that kind of song being sung by characters that aren't romantically involved is just kind of interesting to me. I don't know. Anyway, with this movie, what I also really like with the movie is that, at least for the main characters, they actually got people who can sing. And I gotta make a point with that, because I've noticed, like, I haven't really gone to the theaters and watched, like, a lot of kids' movies specifically lately. Like, I used to when I was little, and I was like, oh, whatever. I grew up watching Megamind, for example. This doesn't apply to, like, this, but I thought I'd make a review of it at some point if you guys want. Anyway, I'd see, like, trailers pop up for kids' movies, or, like, posters, and I noticed all the people that voice the main characters, it's always, like, super well-known celebrities, which, I mean, okay, that's fine, whatever, you want a recognizable voice, but I noticed that some of those kids' movies will be, like, musicals, or they'll have a lot of music, like, outside of stuff from, like, Disney and Pixar, but it's, like, you're getting people where they're just regular actors. Some of them just don't have any singing experience, and you're still getting them to sing? Like, what? It always bothers me, because I'd listen to some of that stuff, and it pops up, or if it gets memed, and it's like, I can tell that they can't sing. Why are you singing? Like, if you really want that person that badly for your movie, like, at least, you know, sometimes in older movies, they dub over, like, someone's singing voice. Like, they did that to Audrey Hepburn in My Fair Lady, for example. Except she could sing, so I didn't know what the deal with that was. Okay, but yeah, Dee Dee Khan, who voices Raggedy Ann, like I mentioned, she was Frenchie in Grease, and Grease is a musical, and she does have to sing in that. And I mean, she still has the same voice, like, while she sings here, while she sings as Frenchie. But, like, it still sounds good, and she can sing. And then with Mark Baker, I'm pretty sure that's his name, the dude who voices Raggedy Andy. I don't think he was any movie stuff, but like I'd mentioned, I read in like the Wikipedia or something that he did like Broadway stuff. And you could tell, like, especially, he can definitely sing. He sounds really good. But yeah, like, the voices match the characters really well. Like, I don't know if that, like, the voice he uses for Andy is like what his natural voice sounds like, but I know for sure that's what Dee Dee Khan sounds like. But yeah, their voices match the characters, but they also sing really well, and when they sing, they still sound like the characters. So I love that. I wish all movies did that, if it was like kids' movies with songs. But anyway, I'd say this is easily the best, like, Andy song in this entire thing. Like, vocally, his voice really shines here. I mean, No Good's Toy is... No Girl's Toy, I'm sad. I'm sorry, yeah, that's what it's called. That one's also a bop, and he also sings that really well. But I like how his voice sounds here, because it's like, it's very gentle, but then there's notes that are like kind of high and really long, is how I describe them. Or like, his voice has to get really strong for some of those notes, and it works. It works great. Okay. And then after that, they sing the song, and then they get through the forest, and then they're in, like, this field or whatever, and the background isn't brown anymore, it's, like, blue, with, like, a ton of stars, because it's still nighttime, you know? Like, they're away from the clouds and the spooky forest, and they're just in this area that's actually completely blue, basically. And then Anne says, "Andy, it's a camel!" And she just sounds so excited for some reason. Oh, right, the thing that leads up to that is they get through the forest, and Anne hears some weird noise and gets scared, and Andy starts running around trying to get the attention of whatever's out there, and you see this camel. It's the camel on the poster. He's called the camel with the wrinkled knees, and Andy tackles the camel, and she gets all excited about seeing the camel for some reason. I just thought that was funny. She's like, "Oh, it's a camel!" And it's like... The camel is basically this movie's version of Eeyore, and his whole thing is that he used to have an owner, and the owner loved him. Like, the owner found him at some like junk shop or something, and then the kid's mom threw the toy out, and the camel's basically been like a hobo just wandering around this entire time, and he used to have sticks in his legs and stuff, but then... he lost the sticks or something, and now because of that his body's all wrinkly and he can't stand up straight anymore, and he's so like old and patched up and broken that like when he walks, it isn't like he's just walking fine on all fours. It's like the front two legs will walk and then the back two legs will walk, but he's so old that his body doesn't really walk together or work as well. So there's times where he's moving around, like especially during his song, where it's like he'll be moving with his front legs and he has to wait for the back ones to like catch up or something. It's kind of sad, but yeah, he's this movie's Eeyore. He's just generally like, oh wait, yeah, he's clearly depressed and just wants to find happiness. That's his whole thing. Like, he keeps seeing this stuff where they'll show his eyes, and his eyes, you know, like when a character is, like, kind of creepy or something, or, like, the Cheshire Cat, for example, where their eyes will turn, like, different colors, kind of rainbowy, and then he looks at the sky, and he sees these hallucinations of these, like, other camels that start singing a song about home or whatever. By the way, I didn't see that song on the soundtrack. It's always, like, the same little bit. I'm pretty sure it's not even an actual song, but it sounds really good. But anyway, yeah, he keeps seeing these hallucinations, and he keeps yelling at the camels, like, "Hey, wait for me," and he tries to follow the hallucinations and stuff, and, because he believes that the camel caravan in the sky is gonna lead him to whatever his home is gonna be. The sad thing is, I've looked through comments and other stuff, and most people think that the camel's actually suicidal, and the hallucinations you get as, like, a metaphor for seeking death or something. And, I mean, they're probably right, and I do believe that the camel's probably a little suicidal, but, like, damn, it's dark, dude. It's sad. Anyway, the camel then, you know, he mentions about the hallucinations, and then he starts singing this song called Blue. And that's probably, like, my third favorite. It's a really good song. Okay, no, if I had to rank these, it'd probably be, Candy Hearts and Paper Flowers. And then it would probably be, No Girl's Toy. And then I Look and What Do I See? And then probably Blue. And that's the thing, because, like, once we get after Blue, there's still more songs, but they're not actually sung by, like, main characters. There's a song that's, like, a villain song or whatever. There's, like, a few. And then there's a few songs that don't do anything to plot. Like, every song after Blue just isn't as memorable as anything in the first half. And they don't get as much runtime either, so... Yeah, I just consider wherever, like, anything before Blue to be, like, the main meat and potatoes music-wise to this movie. Those are, like, the more popular ones, too, so that's understandable. Anyway, yeah, he sings this song called Blue. It's really catchy, actually. I find myself humming it every once in a while, and I really like, because the, I don't know who voices the camel, like, all these actors are, like, people who were, like, actually passed away by now, or were, like, already pretty old when they did the movie, but the camel speaks in this really heavy southern drawl, and the song actually has a banjo in there, so, but the banjo sounds really good. It's a very simple song. It's not, like, the other songs are, like, very high energy and stuff, with the characters dancing around and whatever, and then with Blue, like, the camel's just kind of moping and walking around and whatever. And it's a really good song. I like it a lot. I like the banjo in it. And then I looked up the camel while I was listening to this song. Because I'm like, oh, is this an original character? And I found out he's not only from the original books. Because that's the thing, Raggedy Ann's a doll. But Raggedy Ann and Andy is like an entire book series from like the 20s or something. The camel's an original character for that. Like, he's from the original books. But the plot of the book he's from, he's introduced in, it's called Raggedy Ann and Andy and the Camel with the Wrinkled Knees or something. It's basically this movie's plot. Like, if you go to pull it up on Amazon, Camel with the Wrinkled Knees, let me see if I can find it. Yeah, like, if you look at the plot on Amazon, it says how... Yeah, this doll named Babette gets kidnapped by pirates, and Anne and Andy have to go rescue her. And they end up beating the camel. And then they even mention about, like, a few other things. Well, actually, no. Then they mention about the Land of the Loonies, which is in this movie. So, like, all that stuff I read is the plot of this movie. I thought it was just some, like, whack job plot they made up for this. But no, it's from the actual books. That's how weird the books are. I mean, it mentions about other stuff that they do, like, they find a witch and something about a little girl or whatever, and, like, that isn't part of it, and there's actual original characters for this, but the fact that, like, the main thing of, like, yeah, this doll gets kidnapped by pirates and they have to rescue her is something from the book is just really funny to me. But yeah, the camel I found out from, like, one of the wikis is actually, like, the most popular Raggedy Ann and Andy, like, book series character, besides, like, the duo themselves, obviously. But I could see why, like, my only experience with the camel is in the movie and the music, the actual musical. So I don't know what he's like outside of that. But I like him. I like him in this a lot. He's a very memorable character, and he's, like, yeah, it's about Raggedy Ann and Andy or whatever, but, like, the camel's just as much a part of it, too, and I like that. Yeah, the camel's singing this song about, like, how people shouldn't be happy and singing. And meanwhile, like, that's the thing. Raggedy Ann and Andy, for most of the movie, look like how they do on the poster, like their faces and stuff. But during this song, they have this, like, completely blank-faced look. like with no emotion whatsoever. It's actually in like the same style as when they showed them as like actual dolls in the beginning of the movie. And it's not like, you know, how when a character's super far away, they like don't add a lot of detail to the character's faces. No, there's several shots of them during the song Blue, and they just look like that. Like, they don't make any expressions or anything. They're just kind of, like, blank-faced. But then at some point in the song, they just start dancing along to it. Like the camel's singing about how people shouldn't be happy, and these two are just grooving to it and doing, like, the opposite of what he's singing. I mean, I get it, it's a bop, but in universe, it doesn't make sense. Anyway, then the camel gets a hallucination again after his song, and he's like, yeah, get on my back, come on, guys. And then he really just jumps off a cliff and almost gets them all killed. I'm not kidding, like, he's running and yelling at him to slow down, and then, you know, he's still in the hallucination mode, and then he jumps off the cliff, and they fall in a pit. That's the weird thing, too. That's what made me realize, okay, right, they're dolls, so everything's heavily exaggerated, because they jump in this pit that's full of taffy. And the taffy's basically like an ocean, and then it shows them, like, climbing out on the other side, and you think, wow, that's probably a big amount of space, but it's probably just, like, a taffy puddle or something. But yeah, they meet this taffy monster. He's the big blobby candy thing on the poster. See what he looks like. He's named the Greedy, and I fucking hate his design. Like, on the poster, he looks okay, but he sings this whole song that I don't even remember the name of. And it's weird because he's this gross blob monster, but then for some reason in parts of the song, they give him, like, human-like shapes. It's weird. I don't know what gender he's supposed to be either, because the voice is a male. And, like, he has that face sometimes, but there's parts where he's singing and his body looks like he has breasts and, like, kind of like belly dancers. Like, there's even a part where it looks like he has boobs and there's, like, this waffle thing that kind of looks like a bra, but it's, like, this very male foot. It was weird. I was like, he's literally this gross, like, actually gross blob of taffy. Like, there's times where his nose looks like a pig nose. And he's always making these, like, gross, like, burping noises and stuff because he's eating the whole time. And then they gave him, like, more humanoid, like, forms. It's not like he literally gets a human body or anything, but, like, the taffy in his body would, like, form to look like boobs or something. And I'm like, did they really need to do that, bruh? Very much a fan disservice there. But anyway, yeah, I hate that, but, like, watching the animation of him moving around is, I'm not kidding, it's probably, like, the best animated sequence I've ever seen in anything. Like, holy shit, it's so fluid. Like, it's so good. I was reading about the movie that they had to, like, redo the animation for it, and, like, several of the animators, I think, either, like, quit or got fired or something, because someone wanted to, like, perfect the scene and the animators got tired. But, like, that's understandable. Like, I'm not even doing justice talking about it. If you're gonna watch anything from this movie or, like, get anything from this review, go, like, find the scene with the Greedy from this movie and just, you don't even have to listen to the song. The song's kind of to be honest. But watch the animation for him. Oh my god. Like, yeah, I hate him as a character, though, because he, like, oh, right, back to the animation, like, it's really fluid, and he's this big taffy monster, and he keeps, like, popping up in the forms of the taffy, and he's constantly eating, and there's, like, bits of candy and things floating around, so it's, like, this constant fluid motion, and, okay, yeah, I hate him as a character, because he just constantly, literally eats himself. It's gross, and there's a black background, and something I read is anytime there's, like, a completely black background, it's supposed to be because the scene's supposed to be uncomfortable. I don't know if that's supposed to be for the characters or the viewer, because there's another scene with a black background later that's also probably supposed to be uncomfortable. But at the same time, watching the greedy, especially when Anne tries to have to literally fight him at some point. Oh yeah, that's the thing. He tries to eat Anne later on, and then she tries to fight him, and it turns into a boss fight type thing. He looks, with the way he moves and the candy stuff he tries to throw with them, he looks like he'd be a really fun Cuphead boss. I wouldn't be surprised if someone tried doing, like, fan art of that or something. Though I am saying that as someone who's never played Cuphead, but I've seen, like, little clips and stuff of, like, some of the boss fights and stuff. I feel like he'd be, like, super fun for that, actually. He just gives those vibes. But yeah, there's just, like, this huge puddle of taffy in the ground, and that's what the characters fall into, I guess. I don't know, because, like I said, he's like an ocean for them, basically. But they're, like, these teeny tiny dolls. But yeah, if you want to break down all the characters in the movie that the trio meets, it's kind of depressing. Because, like, the camel's clearly depressed and just wants to find happiness. And he wants to find someone who loves him to the point where he's basically suicidal. And then the greedy, the taffy monster, can't stop eating. And here's a quote here. He says how he can't stop eating because he's never satisfied or happy inside. Which makes him, like, literally and metaphorically a bottomless pit to the point where he wants to eat Anne. Because he sings in his song how he wants a sweetheart. And then Anne, being a dum-dum, mentions how she's a raggedy doll with a candy heart. And so he wants to eat her. Like, he pulls out a pair of scissors and wants to cut her open and eat her heart. And then Anne has to fight him. And, like, the camel and Andy rescue her, and then he basically eats himself to death, I think. I don't know. Like, they shove this huge pile of taffy into his mouth, and then he starts eating and saying how it's really good, and then it shows them, like, climbing out of the pit. So I'm assuming he ate himself to death. I don't know. But, like, yeah, if you think too hard about the characters and their dialogue, you realize, oh, yeah, this movie's, like, way darker and depressing than it needs to be. Like, I'm still thinking about the whole thing, how he says he'll never be satisfied or happy inside. Like, this is a children's film, bruh. Anyway, then they get out of the pit and they go through a forest. Not the forest from earlier, it's like a different forest. Like, they've basically sort of been in this woodsy area this whole time. Like, they jump out the window, they go through some woods, they end up in that weird, like, field meeting the camel. Then they jump off a cliff and fall into a pit. They climb out of the pit, and then they're in a forest again, somewhere else. And then they're in the forest, and there's, like, this funky-looking knight. He's, like, purple and kind of looks a little bit like that one dude from the Wild Thornberrys. Yeah, he looks a little bit like Nigel Thornberry. He gives me those vibes. He doesn't sound like him, though. And he has, like, this tin can kind of armor. His name's the Loony Knight. And his voice sounded really familiar. Especially because the character just kind of gives genie vibes with the way he talks. But he also doesn't sound like Robin Williams. And it turned out to be someone I didn't even recognize for the voice actor. I don't remember who. But it was someone I hadn't heard of. But just bothered me every time the character was on screen. Because I'm like, this voice sounds really familiar. Who is this? And I didn't even know. Anyway, then the Loony Knight wants to take, he pulls some pranks on them, and they're mean, and then he wants to take them to a place called Loony Land, so he, like, pulls this lever, and they end up in, like, the entrance to Loony Land, and then this next section's also really cool, easily one of the best, animated parts of the movie as well. They end up in this black and white room, which is really cool. And there's, like, this whole segment of them being chased in the room. And it feels something straight out of, like, an old-timey cartoon. And I love it. And I'm pretty sure that's intentional. Because it's, like, yeah, they're in color this whole movie or whatever. And it's, like, they go down a thing to Loony Land and the screen cuts to black. And then the screen is, like, normal again. And it's revealed, like, the screen went to black because they're in, like, a black tile of a floor. And then as they're going, like, to the top of the floor or something, it's, like, they change from color to black and white within, like, a few seconds. And then they try and talk to each other, and they can't speak. They can only make, like, sound effect noises. And then there's, like, this piano music that's kind of ragtimey sounding, and they're being chased, and the whole thing feels like a love letter to, like, early 30s cartoons. And I thought that was really cool. Kind of reminded me of Roger Rabbit a little bit in that regard. Yeah, they're being chased by the Loony Knight, and he's also in black and white, I think. No, he's not. There's a few parts in the shots that are actually in color, that anything that has to do with the Loony Knight. Like, there's a part where they're in a, like, black, like, water, and he's looking at them through, like, an eyeglass thing, and that's the only part in the scene that's in color. So I thought that was cool. And yeah, there's parts where they, like, slide down a staircase and whatever, and it's, like, so detailed and so fluid. It's a short little sequence and doesn't really do anything story-wise other than, like, they slide through the floor some more and then end up in Looney Land and then everything's in color again. It's one of those, like, kind of like The Greedy a little bit, where it's kind of just, like, the animator's flex sequence, but it's cool. It's really cool. I just had to talk about that part specifically. And then they end up in Looney Land, and you know it's supposed to be uncomfortable because it was a black background again. And Looney Land is basically just, like, there's these robot creatures. Because it's like there's a king, there's a knight, and there's these robot creatures. And the robot creatures, they're referred to as idiots, and they just laugh all the time, and their job is to make this king laugh. And I like how the robot creatures, like, the subjects in Looney Land, as I'll call them, they're only in primary colors, mostly yellow and blue. And I thought that was an interesting choice. I never noticed that until recently. I feel like it's probably to make them more silly. Because I've noticed whenever something uses, like, a lot of primary colors, it's supposed to, like, make it seem more childish and stuff. And, like, they're these characters that are designed to look really goofy, and their whole point is to make people laugh and stuff. Oh, that's the whole thing. As you know, you got the weird knight who, like, pulls pranks on them. And then there's this king. And the king's, like, super tiny. He's, like, one of those toys or something. Like, the ones that, like, stretch at certain parts. And he's this whole thing where he's tiny. And he wants to grow big because he's the king or whatever. He sings a whole freaking song about it. And then it's revealed that if people laugh at him... Or no, not if people laugh at him. If something makes him laugh, usually through someone being caused pain, it makes him big. But it's not like all of him is big. Only, like, one potty part of him. So it'll be, like, his nose or his butt or something, and that'll get big. Like, it'll expand like a balloon, and then it'll shrink back down. So he's been trying to have all these people make him laugh. And it's basically implied that his court used to be, like, fully sentient beings, whether they were, like, humans or toys or whatever. They were sentient until they couldn't make him laugh. So he punished them by turning them into idiots and making them permanently part of his court, where they lose sentience and they just laugh all the time and do jokes and stuff. And he wants to do the same thing to the main characters. Like, whoa, dude. Yeah, he wants to try that so that he doesn't have to be small. And then they end up getting past him through, they kind of do that thing like in Roger Rabbit, you know, at the end of the movie where, you know, Judge Doom's there and Eddie's like, oh yeah, we gotta make him laugh so they could kill the hyenas. And then he, like, does all this, like, classic joke stuff, like pies in the face or, like, slipping on things, you know, slapstick comedy. They try and do the same thing here, but instead of the characters doing it, they're, like, throwing pies and stuff. And then while the characters are laughing, the trio steals a boat and leaves. And then they end up in the ocean somehow. Yeah, so now they're in the ocean on this, like, goofy-looking boat. It's actually, if you could see on the VHS thing, I don't know if you could see my mouse, but, there's, like, the giant pirate ship, and then the thing to the yellow weird thing to the right with the shoes on it, that's the thing that the characters are in. Anyway, they're in the ocean, and you can see the pirate boat, and they're, like, right behind the boat or something. And seeing the ocean with the detail of the boat looks so cool, honestly. Super detailed. So then they get on the ship, and they're there, and, you know, they went through all this effort, and they just want to rescue Babette. the French porcelain doll, and then it's revealed that Babette actually took over as the pirate captain. Like, the real captain, she locked him in, like, the bottom of the boat or something with this parrot. And she took over as captain. She even has, like, a different outfit and a whip and everything. And she's, like, this respected pirate leader now. It's just weird seeing her go from being, like, the damsel in distress to being the villain. Because that's the thing. Like, the only times we see Babette in this movie is at the beginning when she's introduced and then she gets kidnapped. While she's kidnapped, she's, like, screaming and stuff and freaking out. And, you know, she complained how she wanted to go to Paris. And now she's the pirate captain, and she is basically the villain because, you know, the characters want to take her home and stuff, and, oh, Anne says something to her, too, where she's like, oh, get your things, dear, we're going home, and it softens so sweetly and soft-spoken, it's just the softest little thing. Anyway, yeah, they want to take her home because they came to rescue her, and they tell her that. But she's like, no, I don't want to go back to the playroom. She wants to, like, use the boat to, like, literally try and go to Paris. So she has the... Oh, yeah, there's a crew for this pirate ship. She has them tie up the main characters on the boat. Oh, and then it shows the pirate captain with his parrot, which shown, like, he got locked up or whatever. And here's the thing. I like the songs in this movie, but there's way too many of them. Like, every fucking character gets a song for some reason. Like, when the captain's down there, he sings this song to his parrot about how they're friends, and it's like, there's no point in that song. Like, all the really memorable songs in the first half, but, yeah, there's no point in the song, because, like, none of the other characters hear it. It doesn't have any effect on the main plot. And the captain and the parrot didn't get any character development or were shown. Kind of like with Babette, they got, like, the same amount of, like, screen time. And the parrot isn't even, like, an important character, and I don't care about his friendship with the captain. Like, that wasn't an established thing, but now they're singing this song to each other. Literally no point in the song. Just extends the runtime. So, yeah, then Babette has them tied up or whatever, and they're singing about, going to go back to gay Paris. And no, I'm not just calling it gay Paris. She does refer to it as gay Paris. So that king dude I mentioned, the one that, like, wanted to make them laugh or whatever, it's this weird thing where he's mad that the characters escaped. So he calls a sea monster with a phone, I'm not kidding, and tells them, like, yeah, you gotta go find them or whatever. So then the sea monster is actually in the poster, I'm just realizing it. You see, like, there's a yellow thing with a tentacle in the background? That's the sea monster, except, of course, it's colored wrong, because the sea monster is actually green. But yeah, it's just this, like, squid-looking thing. So yeah, the captain, like, rides on it, not the captain, I'm sorry. The little king dude. Oh, king dude's on the poster, too. He's the little tiny dude all the way on the right with the green hair. Yeah, I forgot about that. Anyway, yeah, the king dude and the sea monster go there together. He's, like, riding the sea monster. They go in the boat, and the king has the sea monster attack the ship. And then it gets weird, because he has the sea monster grab them, and you think, okay, the monster's gonna eat them or something. I mean, I get the king wants to laugh, but it's this weird thing where the sea monster grabs almost all the characters except Babette, the parrot, and Anne, and just starts tickling them. It made me uncomfortable, kind of, because it's like they're laughing and getting tickled, and at the same time, the king's laughing so much he's going, like, bigger, but it's not like he's going bigger by, like, one piece at a time or whatever. He's literally blowing up, like, a balloon. So going from, like, seeing the characters getting tickled while this dude's blowing up, like, one of those I'm messing up my word, you know, the balloon thing. It's like some really weird fetish thing. Like, not for me, but knowing that those kind of things exist, of, like, they're very popular things, I'm assuming, because I'll be, like, looking up something, and then those things will pop up, and I'm like, bruh, I'm just on regular Google Images, I just want to find a picture normally of this character. But, like, the fact that I know those are popular things, and it has, like, the tickling thing and the inflation thing at the same time, just, it feels weird, it makes me wish I didn't know about the internet. Anyway, so that happens. And then I still find it funny that Raggedy Ann doesn't actually save the day. Like, Raggedy Ann doesn't even do anything. Like, she's hiding with Babette, and Babette's, like, in her normal clothes, and she's telling Ann, like, oh, yeah, this is all my fault. I just wanted to go back to Paris. And then the sea monster grabs them and starts tickling them. So the only person who's safe is the parrot, and the parrot actually just goes to and pops the king, actually, with his beak, which I think he blows up and it kills him or something. Like, it doesn't show him dying, but, like, it's kind of implied. Excuse me. And that's when things get weird, because it's, like, they do this thing where the king pops and the screen flashes with lights for a few seconds. Oh, he also says something along the lines of, curse you, Raggedy Ann. And I'm just like, why? Raggedy Ann didn't do anything. But anyway, then he pops, and then it shows a black screen where Ann and Andy are holding hands, and they're falling down this, like, there's, like, these circles on the screen that are supposed to be squirrels, and they're falling through it. And you see the camel falling through it, too, later, and then the only audio is, like, the characters' voices, and you hear Babette say something like, save me, Raggedy Ann, or whatever. So they're falling down this black spiral. I thought that part looked really cool. I don't know why it's there or what it's supposed to mean. I thought it was cool. Like, I got obsessed with this movie after I started watching it, where I got out my notebook and I started drawing stuff. So, like, I drew it all with crayons, too, to match the vibe. So I drew Poggedy Ann. Heck, I actually even painted Poggedy Ann at one point. I might show pictures of that later. But yeah, I colored in Poggedy Ann. And I colored in the shot of Andy in the song No Girl's Toy, where he's got his fists up. And then I colored in the black swirl thing with, like, greenish crayons. It looked cool. Anyway, I like that part. It looks cool visually. So then that happens, and they fall through the little swirly thing. And then it cuts to the IRL stuff, and it shows Marcella in Boots. And it's, like, a day later, maybe, from her original birthday. So, like, the toys have been gone for a while, and then she's, like, standing in water, and she's like, what happened to you guys? And it shows that the characters weren't even in an ocean. They were just in some, like, pond by a neighbor's house. It's, like, a really, really tiny amount of water. Like, not enough to be a puddle, because, like, Marcella's got boots, but it's, like, a little teeny kind of pond. Like, the same amount of water that would be in, like, the bird feeder thingy. So they're just there. She doesn't know how they got there, obviously. So yeah, they didn't travel great distances after all. And they're all scattered around in their IRL forms. Like, Babette is, like, on the side of the water, like, on the ground, and Anne's floating on a piece of wood, and Andy's, like, covered by some leaves or something. And then Marcella just goes and starts picking them up one by one. And seeing that IRL toys just getting picked up by Marcella felt really cute to me, honestly. Kind of like when your toys are scattered everywhere when you're done playing with them when you're a kid, and then you just go and you just start picking them all up. Like she's not even mad or anything of, like, that her toys almost got, like, soaked. That's the other thing. They were on a boat, and the king exploded, and you think that would have, like, caused everything to get wet. But the only thing that ended up getting wet was the pirate captain's boat. And she's like, Captain, your boat or something. That's the only comment she makes. Everyone else is, like, clean and dry. Which is glad, because if something like Babette with her, like, fancy dress ended up getting soaked, I would have gotten kind of pissed. Because those things always bother me. But anyway, she picks up all the toys, and then it's revealed that, the camel is there, too. The camel's, like, just off-screen. Because, like, Marcella picks up her toys, and she goes into a house somewhere, and she's like, let's get home, you're gonna get a cold. And then it shows the camel was off-screen, and it goes to a shot of just the camel, and he's, like, his face is poking out of a giant pile of leaves. So it's like he's still sort of visible, like, you could see his face, but, like, he's mostly under the leaves, and he was like far enough away where my son didn't notice him, and it's kind of sad because it's like he's forgotten again. He could have gotten like taken home, and he didn't because she didn't see him. And then it shows that shot again where he's under the leaf pile with his face. Like, they didn't move him or anything, but this time it's night. So the only thing we see is, like, the camel's head and some of the leaves, and then it's darkness around him. And it's just that shot, especially with the IRL toy, which felt so sad to me, honestly. Then it gets animated again for that part, and the camel starts seeing his, like, visions again. And the thing is, I think he's, like, right outside of Marcella's house or something, because it shows, like, the camera vision's pointing to an open window, and then it's revealed, like, that's the window where Anne and all the characters are. Oh, and then, wait, hold on. Where are my notes for this? And Anne starts singing some song. I don't remember if I had written it in my notes or not, but Anne starts singing some song. Because now they're back inside the house, and Anne and Andy are reunited with everyone, and they're talking about the adventure, and then Babette apologizes. Like, everything's sort of back to normal. Like, Babette apologizes for causing so much trouble, and then the captain ends up with Babette at the end for some reason. I don't get that, because, like, he was horny for her and kidnapped her, and she, like, very much was not cool with that. And then she took over his ship and locked him in the ship basement. And then, of course, he still likes her. Like, he's kind of more bashful about it. And she's fine with it. She says something to him like, oh, yeah, you're... So he says something like, I still love you, Babette. And she's like, oh, you're such a romantic captain. You can come visit me on Sundays or whatever. Like, she just is romantically interested in him for some reason. Like, he kidnapped her, and then she took over his boat, and she just likes him now. Like, I could get it, understand it if it was, like, she was, like, kept prisoner, and it was, like, Stockholm Syndrome or something. But, like, it felt more like a one-sided crush. I don't understand why. I could see now why people... Oh, that's the other thing. People ship Raggedy Ann with Babette. And I feel like there's more evidence for that than, like, her being with the captain, because, like, her and the captain have no scenes together. But it's kind of, like, almost shown that Anne kind of likes Babette a little bit. I feel like it's almost a little implied. Not, like, through any lines, but, like, when during Babette's, like, introduction scene and she's singing, like, Anne would, like, say stuff or, like, kind of look really, really happy. And then there's this shot towards the end where Babette apologizes to her and gives her a hug. And you could see Anne, because Anne's a lot smaller. And, like, you see it from Anne's point of view. Like, Anne's the one facing the camera. And then she just kind of buries herself under Babette's curls. So, like, I could see why, and I almost wish, like, okay, yeah, I wish she'd ended up, if they were going to give Babette a love interest, I wish it was Anne instead. Anyway, then it's really sweet seeing all the toys love Raggedy Ann and hug her when they go home. Like, that was really wholesome, because they care about her a lot, because she's, like, the group's sweetheart or whatever. So that was cool, and she sings this song about being home, and, like, all the toys hug her and stuff, and they all, like, get a line. And even the captain's kind of accepting the group. Like, he doesn't hug Anne or anything, but, he's not trapped in the snow globe anymore. And he gets to chill in the playroom and ends up with Babette, and Babette is actually fine with staying in the playroom, because now she's with the captain. But yeah, I completely forgot about the song Anne that sings at the end, but I like it. But one of my favorite things is how much Anne and Andy just love the camel. Like, even from the very start, like, he sings his song Blue, and they feel sorry for him, and they hug him. Like, these two characters never really agree on anything. Like, they have very different reactions and stuff, but they both, like, immediately just love the camel as, like, their bestest friend. And there's times where, like Anne thanks Andy and the camel for rescuing her, and she hugs them both and kisses the camel. And then they, like, Anne sees the camel outside the window, and she's like, we gotta let him in, and all the toys, That's the thing. It's not just Anne and Andy that are excited, but all the toys are just hyped to have the camel join them. And it's, like, such a cute scene because, like, they let him in, and I remember you could hear, like, the characters as Anne's opening the door, and you hear Andy say something like, let him in or whatever, and it's just, like, they're all so excited, and Anne introduces the camel, and she's like, yeah, this is our friend, the camel, and the toys say something like, oh, yeah, any friend of Raggedy Ann is a friend of ours or something, and they're just so welcoming to him, and it's really sweet, especially because, like, they sang that whole song to Babette, and she was mad at them or whatever because she wanted to go to Paris, but, like, they're even more welcoming and happy with the camel, and the camel's just so happy by that, like, then they start continuing the song or whatever. Oh, yeah, yeah, the last song is, they sing Candy Hearts and Paper Flowers again, but it's, like, all the characters singing, and then at the end of that song, the camel, gets hugged by Raggedy Ann and Andy, and the camel actually starts crying because he's so happy that these other toys love and accept him, and it's just so wholesome. The only kind of sad thing is how, like, earlier in the movie, the camel complained when he was introduced because he doesn't have sticks in his legs anymore, and how annoying it is that he's always wrinkled and his body's falling apart. But then two of the toys, specifically the old man with the four arms and the pincushion lady, they're, like, the ones that just sort of fix up the toys throughout the movie. Like, they're seen when the characters get home and one of them's, like, sewing up Andy or something. But, yeah, those two toys straight up offer to fix the camel. They're like, yeah, we could get you new sticks and, like, patch you up. And Anne just shoots them down and doesn't let the camel answer for himself. Like, it's kind of sweet because she says something, like, they offer to fix him, and she's just like, oh, we love him the way he is, and he doesn't, like, defend himself. And it's, like, it's sweet that they love him, like, even in the state that he's in, but, like, the dude complained about being all raggedy and old and not having sticks in his legs, and it's like, bro, you shot down his chance. Because it's not like Anne and Andy always stay up in, like, a patched-up shitty condition or something, because it's shown at the beginning and the end of the movie. Like, in the beginning of the movie, Anne, like, when she first comes to life, is, like, kind of like, whew, my cellum's rough with me today, and then you see the toys, like, adding more yarn to Anne's hair and sewing her up. So it's like, okay, they get to get, like, repairs and stuff, but the camel doesn't, bruh. But anyway, yeah, the toys sing to the camel, and he cries and gets so happy, and it's so cute. And then it goes back to, like, everything freezes, because it goes back to the IRL stuff. You actually see the little Anne and Andy doll, like, with the camel with his arms around him, and that shot's really cute. But anyway, then Marcella shows up in the room. They freeze because she's coming. They have to do that just like with Toy Story. Anyway, she comes in, and she picks up the camel and just kind of looks at it and moves it around a little bit because, you know, she knows, like, all her toys by heart, and this isn't one of her toys. Because, like, the camel's outside, and she didn't notice it, remember? So it's like, she's coming back to her room, and there's just, like, this weird-looking camel that wasn't there before that just appeared in her room. But then she smiles, and she hugs the camel. And then the last shot in the movie is actually, like, Marcella hugging Anne and, no, Anne, Andy, and the camel. It's just so sweet, because, like, she doesn't, you could tell she doesn't know where this toy came from, but just accepts him right away, anyway, as one of her own, and that's just so cute, because, like, okay, because I mentioned about all the toys being ugly, except for Anne and Andy, and the trash bag and the sock. The camel's actually a really cute toy. Like, you look at the picture, and, like, in the VHS thing, and you think, oh, yeah, he's so wrinkled, he probably looks gross or something. Because he looks so, like, tired and raggedy and everything, no pun intended there. But then you look at the toy, and it's, like, the eyes are more, like, opened, and he, like, he has the stitches, but the stitches are less of, like, literally stitching them together and more, like, just a design. Kind of like that villager Stitches, the bear. Like, I have a plushie of him, and he has stitches, but they're just, like, decorative. They're not literal stitches. But yeah, that's what the camel's like. The camel, like, go look up a toy. Actually, no, if you watch the movie and you look at the IRL thing for the camel, like, go look at that. he's cute, and she just accepts him, and that's the last shot of the movie. And I really like that. I actually like that the camel actually had more focus than Babette, the person they were trying to rescue. It's like the real main characters in this. It's called Raggedy Ann and Andy, but it should be called Raggedy Ann, Andy, and Andy, and the camel with the wrinkled knees. That's what the original book's called, so there you go. Yeah, that's all my notes, and that's the end of the movie. It's definitely weird and kind of dark, but it has a lot of moments that are really wholesome. I love the characters and the voice acting and the music. And there's a lot of little details they didn't have to put in, but they did anything. And of course the animation's amazing. Because that's the thing, before YouTube started recommending this movie to literally everyone and creating a fandom at that point, yes, there's a Raggedy Ann and Andy, like, musical adventure fandom now. What was I gonna say? Yeah, the only people who'd really know about this movie from, like, what I've read and stuff were, like, hardcore, like, animation students, basically, or anyone who's super into animation. And the general consensus with this movie was, like, it wasn't good, but the animation was amazing, and that was it. But, like, nowadays, people discover this movie and how wholesome it is, and it's sort of more like a little cult classic now. Like, people are actually appreciating the movie for, like, the other elements, too. Because, of course, the animation is, like, mind-blowing, but there's other stuff in this movie that's actually good. Like, I wouldn't say it's, like, the most amazing movie I've ever seen. There's a lot of elements that really work. And I wouldn't recommend it to everyone either, because I feel like some people would probably find it, like, too corny or kind of dumb. I mean, it is still, at the end of the day, like, a children's movie about a rag doll, but it's pretty good for, like, what it's got, and it's more wholesome and has a lot more heart and effort than you'd expect, so I'd still recommend this to anyone who found, like, this review interesting. Oh, yeah, I mentioned there's a musical. It's not like with the Portal 2 stuff where it's, like, they have the game and they made the musical based on the game. Like, there's stuff in the musical that's inspired by the movie. Like, the camel has the exact same design, and the costumes are the same and everything. But the camel and Raggedy Ann and Andy are the only, like, characters that are in both. And it has this original plot. The musical has this plot where, like, Babette's not even in the thing, of course. None of these characters are. But, Marcella is this little girl with a heart condition, and she's going to die. And everyone tells her she's gonna die. And Raggedy Ann and the toys come to life, and they go on this adventure actually with Marcella this time. Though you're not sure if the whole thing's a dream or not, and they're trying to get her to, I'm not kidding, they're trying to get her to the doll doctor in Los Angeles or something so that she can be saved and doesn't die. That's the plot of this movie, and it gets so much darker from there. But, you know, I had to talk about the movie first so you could, like, see visuals of the characters and stuff. But yeah, this is the movie. The movie's a lot more wholesome, so I wanted to also talk about that first. Just have, like, a nice little, like, introduction to Raggedy Ann before I start hitting you with the deep stuff. But yeah, that's the review of the movie. Hope you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching. Oh, and sorry if I spoiled everything. Even if you watch this whole thing and I spoil stuff, I'd still recommend watching the movie anyway. But yeah, thanks for watching. Bye-bye.